an awakening special tonight. I know I'm not normally on, because I'm on every fortnight, but we couldn't help but put a show on tonight because we are joined in the studio all the way from Queens and Brooklyn. I'll make sure I get this right. I'll get myself into trouble. By Chris Thompson and Richard Dauphin. Welcome, welcome to the show, guys.
Welcome, it's good to be here. Good to be here.
It's a beautiful thing. It's a beautiful thing to be out here.
Oh,
Birmingham,
wow.
What up?
How are you finding it? You're here in the UK, first time here as well. What are your first impressions?
My first impression was like, wow, driving is definitely a different experience.
Oh, yeah. That was literally my first impression too. Like, it was just like, wait a minute, the steering wheel, can we just put it back on the other side? And can we drive on the proper side of the street? And the roundabouts? What is that about?
Do you know, that is, we ask that question because everywhere you go, there's a roundabout. Like, it's a bit unnecessary.
Yeah, and we're drivers, and I drive on a regular basis, but right. Seeing how everything goes here is like, okay.
I'm not driving.
Where were the rules?
My will to live is strong out here.
Okay, well, aside from the roundabouts and the other side of the road, we're pretty normal.
Yeah, I love the architecture of all the buildings and the structures. Everything nice. Has this, you know, very classic, you know, eclectic look to it. So it's definitely, appreciate it.
Good. So, I mean, you're from New York. Chris, you're from Queens.
You already know.
Yeah. And Richard, you're from Brooklyn.
Yes.
Yeah, making sure I get this right. So tell us a bit about where you're from, because we all know New York, but we've seen it, most of us have seen it in the films, Coming to America, things like that.
Yeah. So, juice. Slice juice.
Exactly. So we've got probably a little bit of a warped view of what it's like to be from New York. I mean, right. What are the, some of the contrast between there and here? That you'd recognize since you've come over?
Well, I think, for one, the cars are like so
tiny
or small. Like, you know, all the cars are pretty much small. And, you know, we, big cars is like on a regular basis. Like, right. You know, even our small cars might be considered big here, you
that's
know?
True.
So,
yeah, you have those massive, like, in fact, yeah, they are kind of massive, the cars.
Yeah, like, I drive a Jeep.
Okay.
And it's pretty big. But like when I get into like Roger's car, I don't know, he has like a Ford Focus, I think.
Yeah.
Man, it's like super tiny. My knees are like where the headlights should be. They're like poking out. And I'm like 6'6", so.
I was about to say,
it's definitely 6 foot ceiling.
6 foot
ceiling. And you know, and.
This guy.
So let's talk about your music, because you're here for the GL Live concert happening this Saturday.
Thanks.
How did this come about? Because you're performing on stage at the Drum on Saturday. Mm-hmm. How did it come about, the collaboration and the whole thing with you guys coming over here?
You wanted to get it? All right. Well, we have a common friend, a promoter from New York that does a lot of great things for Christian hip hop in the States. Mm-hmm. His name is Marcus Hall and
Kingdom Time Entertainment.
Shout out to them. They brought us out here, man. And you know, we have he knows Roger, and Roger was asking for some artists or what have you, and then Marcus basically just, you know, told him about us, and Roger listened to the music and stuff, and he, you know, he's like, I'm with it. And then Slave, who's gonna be here Friday, he was already out here a few years ago, I think. So you know, that's basically how the connection really happened.
Okay. So over in the States, with your music, I mean, you've just released a new album, haven't you? Called Welcome to the Truth, Chris.
Yeah.
And what's the reception been like with the release of that album?
Man, it's been a lot of love. Like, it is so much love. The project is getting, the single is getting moved around a lot. A lot of people calling, a lot of people texting, a lot of people emailing as well. So the support has just been really, really wonderful. I love it. I really do.
Good, okay. Well, we're going to play a track off the album in just a second. This track's called I Ain't Who I Was?
Yeah.
So what's this track all about?
So basically, man, you know, people, when you're a believer, and when you become a believer and you just say, you know what, God, I give it all to you, and you kind of go back and you see people that knew you before you became this new creature in Christ, you know, they try to, like, say, you know, hey, well, you know, let's pick up right where we left off, and you got to let them know, like, I ain't who I was, you know what I'm saying? Like, I don't do that anymore. I don't, you know, I don't fellowship with these people anymore, you know what I'm saying? And it also speaks to, even while you're growing in the Lord, like, you grow in the Lord, and, you know, from one year to the next, you shouldn't be who you used to be in the Lord, you know what I'm saying? Your relationship with Him and the depth of it should grow. So that's basically what it's about. But yeah, featuring my man The Saga, TH3 Saga, and my boy Ishan Burgundy, that's my guy.
Okay, so this track's called I Ain't Who I Was, off the album Welcome to the Truth.
Yeah.
I Ain't Who I Was by Chris Thompson. Yeah. That beat is a bit like, it's just, you can't help but not move to it.
I hope so.
Mad. Oh, I really love it. Really, really like it. Now, Richard, you're also, you've released a new track as well more recently. Tell us a bit about what inspires your music and your artistry.
I believe my artistry definitely stems from what I experience, what I see going on, and definitely what I'm passionate about. You know, the single Revolution music really came from, you know, I work, you know, I'm very active in my community, you know, helping out with kids as far as like the education, putting on programs even for them to develop, even developing the arts, from dance to music. You know, we have a studio where I'm at, so we have the kids come out to the community center. You know, we provide numerous amounts of services to the community, and in that community, which is in Harlem where I work at, you know, I see a lot of the hurt, a lot of the gun violence is on an all-time high, you know, drugs, and a lot of our kids are in a state of hopelessness, you know. So the song Revolution music, coming from as being a man of God, you know, who's active, and of course I want all men that they should be saved, you know, but then also there's a need for to instill hope, and there's a need for servitude in those communities, you know, outside of necessarily the death, burial, and resurrection, even though that's at the top of the list of what they need, you know, but people need hope, and they need resources, they need outlets, and the song Revolution music is a song that is really like kind of like a cry for believers and a cry for people to be active and not just look at what's wrong and be like, man, hopefully someday it'll change. No, but take an active role in actually being the change that you want to see in the community. So
definitely. And I mean, New York has notoriously been a place of violence, you know, we've heard so many different things. How do you inspire and influence people, your peers, being in such an environment? Because I mean, surely people look, I mean, is it easy to minister in this way?
I mean, what I've noticed, and on a regular basis, I think that, now, like I said in the song, one person can't reach everybody, you know what I mean? But anybody can reach somebody. You know, with my song, there's certain people that I know that by hearing my voice, they could definitely, okay, you know what, I relate to you, you know? And there's another person I might not be able to reach, but they'll relate to somebody. But if we were all active in taking the initiative, you know, and being proactive in trying to make a difference in the community, I mean, half the problem is already going to be solved. But I think a lot of times we think that leave it up to somebody else to do, or thinking somebody should definitely save and look, and people waiting for somebody to do something that they can do themselves, you know. Yeah. But we're not thinking like that, because unfortunately we're just stuck in our own worlds and in our own realms, only concerned about us, and we need to break out of that and really think about the people who are around us in our communities, you know, especially as believers.
Definitely. Well, we're going to hear from you now. This track is called Revolution Music. It's the latest track. Is it from an EP?
Yes, this is definitely from an EP, and it's actually the first single off my upcoming project, which is going to be released next month. It's going to be called Evolution. I said but this song is an evolution, you know what I mean?
Is that your project?
Exactly. Yeah, man, it's going to be, my new project is called Elevation, man. So this is the first single. It's going to be out next month, so I need everybody to definitely go ahead and check it out. The music video's out right now, so y'all can definitely go ahead and check it out, man. Revolution Music.
Revolution Music. Okay, well, we're going to play your track now. This track's called Revolution Music.
Let's get it. appreciate it.
Love that track, and yours also, Chris. I mean, tell me a bit about how you kind of came, what was the wake-up call for you? Because you haven't been in church all your life, have you?
No, definitely not.
How old were you when you realized that God had really put a calling on your life?
Well, I'll start off, I believe that I'm got received not my call from the Lord when I was in college. I mean, I'm going into college. I wasn't brought up in necessarily a Christian home, even though my parents, you know, I'm from Haitian descent, so it was all, it put me in private school. So I had an idea of who God was, but as far as like having a relationship with him, that was completely foreign, and that was just like something completely, I'm thinking you meet God when you die, you know, and just act your best to be let in to his kingdom, you know. That was my concept of God. And lo and behold, while I'm going in college, I'm all about trying to get money, trying to get girls, and trying to get into this music industry and utilize my talents to network. But while I was in that process of just basically just trying to go for me, I didn't like church, didn't believe in any pastors. This thought of, you know, listening to some pastor on a Sunday was like the most boring and just like dumbest thing to do in my mind. That's what I was thinking, you know. But while I was going to college, God had other plans. I went to college for one thing, and he had a completely different plan. So majority of people kept on witnessing to me, random people. And where one person would leave off, another person would pick that up. And then I was just completely confused. Why is everybody telling me and talking to me about God? The RA at the time in the dorms, you know, she was coming to me and be like, you know what?
So hold on, what's an RA?
RA, yeah, I was thinking, like, do you have an RA? Yeah, yeah. That was basically the person that's in charge of the dormitory.
Okay.
So it's like, usually like another student.
Like a prefect.
Sometimes it would be a student. What do y'all call it?
Like a prefect?
The manager of the dormitory where all the kids stayed at off campus, okay. Right? She would always tell me, like, listen, you know what? You know you have a call on your life. I'm like, what are you talking about? And she was like, you know, God wants to use you. I'm like, why? You know, it just sounded real foreign, that whole concept, you know. And then one night, you know, I was just saying, like, you know what? She kept on talking to me. You need to get in church. You start reading the word, And then all of a sudden, I was just like, okay, you know, let me give it a shot. Couldn't get it. One night, I fell asleep. And then, lo and behold, I was just in this kind of like a trance. It sounds kind of crazy. You know, it was caught up in this trance. And then I'm thinking, like, what's going on? I'm feeling all scared. You know, like, what's going on? Because I couldn't open up my eyes. So I was, like, thinking I'm bugging out. And then, lo and behold, when I finally did open my eyes, I felt nothing but the presence of evil around me. And I was scared. True story. I ain't come all the way to lie to nobody.
I was just like, that was like a cliffhanger, a duff moment on EastEnders, but you won't know what that
is. Absolutely. I had this moment, and then next thing I was scared. And what made me most scared is that I was scared to pray. And then I remember, I couldn't pray. Like, I know I needed to pray, but I felt like I couldn't pray because I was so scared, you know. And I felt like the presence of evil all around me. And then I'm over here like, what's going on? I'm thinking I'm gonna lose the crazy. I'm like, God, what do you want from me? And then I heard a small, still voice that said, reach people through music. And then I just went into a sleep.
Wow.
Woke up the next morning, like, what's going on? I called the person, the RA, like, you ain't gonna believe what happened to me. I was sleeping in, and I told her everything. She was just, I couldn't get in contact with her for like a week. So when finally the end of that week came, I'm calling her, like, hey, what happened? You tell me what happened. You know, I'm telling her, and then she tells me, like, what day was that? I told her it was Wednesday. And then lo and behold, it was like, wow, for some reason, God called me to fast all week. And then on that particular Wednesday, I was with my mother, and who was actually praying and interceding, you know, for you on that particular day, night, when everything had happened. And then she was like, you know what, Rich, you need to give your life to the Lord. Give your life to the Lord. What does that mean? I've never heard of, you need to be saved. What do you mean be saved? You know, so she led me through the sinner's prayer. This was in my dorm. Wasn't at no church whatsoever, you know, but right in my college dorm, I accepted Jesus as my personal savior. And then from right then and there, I was completely, like, almost instantaneously a new person, you know. As I began to grow into the knowledge of the faith, that's when my eyes lit up, and I'm like, listen, I wasted 18 years of my life. I need to know everything there is to know. I need to know about this God. I was saved to the point I stopped going to class in certain classes. Like, what am I going to go to economics for? I need to learn about Genesis and find out about this Jesus, you know, what's going on, you know. But that was where my hunger and zeal was. And then going from there, as my hunger and passion for the Word of God, I couldn't help but be compelled to tell people about it. So I was going around my college campus telling people and evangelizing, telling them about the Lord. And lo and behold, now, you know, I stand before everybody like a reverend of the gospel, a person that hated preaching, thought that was the most ridiculous concept there was. And now I stand here before you guys as a reverend, you know, and we preach actively in my church, you know, and also get a lot of invitations to preach in other churches. So that's just how he did it. And I'm just going hard now, looking back, And I ain't who I was, you know what I mean?
Thank you.
Plug, you know what I mean? Plug, you know what I'm saying?
Man.
You see how I set the alley-oop for you?
Appreciate it.
You know what I mean? Threw it off the backboard for you, man.
No, that was, I mean, what a testimony. That is like, I mean, it's not everybody that has such a great, you know, big, it's so apparent for them. It's, sometimes it's just a gradual process, but I suppose that's unmistakable. How did you, have there been any struggles along the way? I know you said you changed instantaneously, but I mean, what about temptations and things like that?
Absolutely. But the change was, what changed is now my hunger and thirst grown and it increased to want to know everything there was about God. Yeah. You know, and it felt like almost instantaneously God changed me. But not to say the temptation that I had, now I realize what temptation was, because prior to, I had no temptation. I was doing whatever the heck I wanted to do, you know. Now, as I began to grow and I realized what sin was, now I'm realizing, okay, now it's kind of like, okay, now you're stepping in the ring. Mm-hmm. Now you're getting ready to know, because now if I'm trying to live after this God and follow after his rules, now I had to, God, you got to help me with my lust. God, you're going to have to help me, you know what I mean, so I can live my life for you. And now I had to learn about what trusting in his will is, knowing that God wants you to do one thing, and you're like, this doesn't make sense, but go blindly towards the small, still voice of the Lord, you know, and it's a process. Certain things, like as far as like lust, wasn't something that was done overnight. No, it's a process. Certain things that I know I had to rely on God to do, certain relationships I had to cut off, which is probably one of the most difficult things for me at the time, because you know, when you're with somebody that you think, oh, you and me, girl, we going from now until eternity, you know, and then now I'm like, oh, I can't do this, because now it's either my relationship with God is more important, more prevalent, and that's never an easy situation, you know. But thanks by the grace of God, I was able to sever some ties, you know, in order to grow and make plenty of sacrifices, which was definitely no easy task. You know, even to this day, there's plenty of times where I go through, even as a reverend, I go through, you know, as far as like doubt and trusting in God. And just because we're saved, that doesn't mean that we're exempt from trial. We're not exempt from tribulation. We're not exempt from life. I mean, we all have to deal with hardships. Jesus said, in this world, you are going to be faced with tribulations. Many are the afflictions of the righteous, you know, but the Lord is going to deliver us through them all. You know, like, yeah. I think I preached in a sermon, it's like, your salvation is free, but there's a cost to carry the cross, you know, and we all have to maintain what God has given us. Same way, if somebody gives you a car and it's for free, you didn't have to pay for it, but you still have to deal with the maintenance, the tune-up. You still have to deal with the insurance. You still have to pay, you know, all these different things to actually maintain what you've been given. So that's definitely a parallel to our Christian walk.
And I want to come back to that in just a second. But, Chris, I mean, that Richard's testimony is very, very inspiring. What about yourself? How did it happen for you?
Well, for me, I want to say that I used to always go to church with my mother, but I didn't technically grow up in church. I wasn't, you know, part of the plays or, you know, stuff like that. You know, it just wasn't there, you know, night service and stuff like that. I just didn't. My mother always had us in church. We were always there, but I can't really say that we were locked into the culture of church. Mm-hmm. When I got older, I just kind of stopped going to church. And my thing was like money and women. And I wanted to sell drugs. I saw a lot of that in my neighborhood, and that's what I did. And I'm going to be honest with you, man. From the time I was like maybe 12 years old, I can't even say 12, maybe about 11. Yeah, 11 years old, you know, I was smoking weed, hanging out, drinking and stuff like that. And by the time when I was 12, I actually was going into the seventh grade. I got kicked out of like 6 junior high schools in the seventh grade. That's like middle school from like sixth grade or from seventh grade to eighth grade, sometimes ninth grade. That's what we call it, middle school.
Yeah.
So I got kicked out of 6 of those in the same year. And what happened was, you know, things just spiraled out of control then, and all the way up until high school. And then, you know, I ended up, you know, graduated high school and I went on to college. And when I went to college, I realized like, yo, the land is ripe for selling drugs. You know what I'm saying? And I ended up going out there and I started selling drugs where I was at upstate New York in school. And I ended up faltering at being a drug dealer. Not really faltering, but
faltering.
It was bad funny, but I ended up like just selling drugs, and everybody knew I sold drugs, and I was doing good. But then I came back to the city, and I didn't have any more money. I didn't have any more drugs. My connections were all dried up, and there were plenty of things that happened along the way, you know, that God really showed me, like, that was him turning off the faucets that I had turned on, yeah, and pretty much locking them. And I got back here, to the city, back to New York City, and I wanted to kill myself. I didn't want to live anymore because I was so driven by money and beautiful, you know, things like cars and jewelry and, you know, women and stuff. Like, I was driven by those things. And when I didn't have them anymore, it was like, what's the sense of living? You know what I'm saying? So I ended up going in my room, and I had my gun, and I put my gun in my mouth, and I was going to kill myself. And my mother came, and she knocked on the door, and she was like, you know, you should try going to church. And being that I didn't grow up in church, but I was always around and going to church, when I was like, that's not what I want to do. I'm not doing that. And she was like, you know what, just give it a try. And I went downtown to my uncle's church, which is in Harlem. And God really began to change my life at that point. And I just stopped hanging out. I stopped smoking. I stopped drinking. And then September 24th, 2000, I went to see the rapper Mace when he had his, like, big conversion. I went to go see him preach in Brooklyn. And I bought his book. And that was what really solidified it for me. I just stopped everything. I stopped selling drugs. I stopped hanging out. I stopped everything. And from that day till now, I've been living for the Lord. I mean, well, except for yesterday, because I punched Richard in his face. But,
yes, on two occasions. But God is able.
On two occasions.
Yeah, man.
You guys are really close, though, aren't you? Because yeah. I see a camaraderie between you, like a brotherhood.
That's my friend. I'm, me and Richard have been friends, I want to say, since, well, Mecca's not here, which is the timekeeper of our friendship.
And the RA, the manager of the campus that led me to the Lord. So right. She actually ended up being my manager.
Oh,
yeah,
wow.
She's a very beautiful person, just outgoing. But Rich is my guy. I've been knowing him since like 2004. Mecca gonna kill me if I'm wrong, because she gonna be like, no.
It was this particular day. You had on this shirt.
She knows. Right, well, we're going to play some more music from you, Chris. I mean, yeah. I'm going to let you choose. What do you want
to
hear?
Let's go to Freedom.
Freedom? Okay. So this is the recently released track, isn't it?
Yep. Video is out on YouTube as well. Check that out.
Okay. And what's this one about?
Freedom, exactly what it is, man. You know, freedom from bondage. You know, religious bondage and traditional bondage and bondage, period. Just all across the board. It's featuring my boy Kadeem Nichols. He's actually got a project out right now called The Unusual, but he's so dope. Shout out to Kadeem. Shout out to my boy, that the producer, his name is Feed Me STK. My boy Nate Johnson, he produced the record. So yeah, shout out to them.
Okay, shout out to them. This track's called Freedom from Chris. Hope you enjoy it. New Star Radio 98.7. That track was called Freedom from Chris Thompson's album Welcome to the Truth.
Uh-huh.
I'm joined in the studio by Chris and Richard.
Yes, sir.
Yes, miss.
Yes, my fault. Yes, sir. Ma'am. Is just like a regular, like,
oh, right.
Like, yes, sir. You know what I mean? And I'm like, oh, I'm not. No, not just. Yes, ma'am.
Oh, thank you.
Yes, ma'am. Okay. Yes, miss.
Yeah. Anyway. So that track was called Freedom. And, you know, you talked about your testimony and yes. How you kind of came to the Lord. How do you mind me asking how old you are?
I am 32.
32, okay.
32.
So you're a young guy. Yeah. So how do you manage to communicate your journey and, you know, really relate to the young people in your community back home?
I think with me, but I try to just be myself.
Mm-hmm.
I think what people fail in doing is that when they come to God, and yes, they've been washed by his blood, their minds have been renewed, and they are the righteousness of God, but then again, they forget how to be. I think we spend so much time abstaining from the ways of the world,
mm-hmm,
that we become no longer relevant to the world, and we are no longer able to speak to those people who were lost, and we act as if we were not lost at one time, you know. And then I started thinking about myself. I was just like, you know what, even though I'm living for God, and I'm like, wow, you know what, I want people to see Christ through me as I am. And I never wanted to, yes, God, I want you to change everything that's not like you, but as far as like my personality, that's what draws and that's what connects with people, you know. So I think as a believer, I try to just be me, you know, be who I am. I like to joke, you know. When you see, I mean, you, anybody sit in a room with me and Chris, we're joking like 24, like nonstop. It's hard for us to stay serious, but both of us, I think I can say for both of us, like, you know, we're both kind of like magnets for people. People are not always drawn to us, and I think what they're drawn to is our transparency. They're drawn to the fact that we are just very relatable, that, you know, we are guys that like to have fun. We're regular people, you know. Then when as people are drawn to us, and then through our lifestyles, they see, hold on, even though I like being around you, there's something different about you. And there's something about you that's different. What is that thing? And then that thing, that's when we introduce him to Jesus. People all the time, maybe there's something different about you. What is it? I was like, what is it? Is the fact that I love God, man. And what you're attracted to is not necessarily rich, but what you're attracted to is the God in rich. And then by building relationships, it's easy to witness. It's not even a difficult thing because you have actually already gained people's interest, you know. So I think through relationships, that's like my main thing, you know, as far as relating to people. Not no big, long, drawn out, it's not no hard process. It's just by being you and being able to relate to people.
We're going to talk more about that after the news. We'll be back right after this.
The
Waiting Show on New Star Radio 98.7 with me, Dana, and my guests this evening, Richard Dauphin and Chris Thompson.
You don't have to say my whole name, you know.
So what's your stage name?
I just go by Chris.
Just Chris?
Yeah.
Okay, so Richard and Chris.
I'm Richard Dauphin. It's one word.
You're Richard Dauphin. Okay, I'll make sure I get that straight.
Nice.
Just before the advert break, Richard, you were talking about kind of, you know, your journey and stuff like that. But Chris, I really want to know from you, we're talking about the church because you talked about, you know, how you came to the Lord.
Yeah.
How do you think, in what ways does the church need to stay relevant? And do you think it is relevant to a generation that is coming from the background that you were coming from?
No. In a lot of cases, I'm not going to say all churches, but a lot of churches are definitely, I want to say maybe 10 years behind. So their message, their attempts at gathering young people, because we did concerts back in the 60s and the 70s, so that should work now. Nah, you gotta change the bait. And a lot of churches, you know, they still like, you know, well, it's holiness or hell, and like, you know, nothing that we do, our attempts at holiness, our attempts at righteousness, the Bible says our righteousness is as filthy rags. So when we attempt to create this facade of perfection, you definitely, the younger people in the younger generation definitely look at you crazy, because they're like, yo, you saying all of this stuff, but meanwhile you put your pants one leg on, you know, put your pants on one leg at a time, you know, just like I do. So what makes you any better, or what makes you even, you know, any worse than I am, or what have you? So at the end of the day, I really feel like our relevancy to the church and our message, or our relative
help me out, Richard.
Just help me out here.
Being
relative to people, being able to relate to the young people, that has to come from, you know, people who are in love with seeing young people strive and seeing young people in the building and seeing young people moving in God. It can't be just a, you know, a shouting good time every trip. You know what I'm saying? It's got to be some type of perfection and some, not perfection, but some type of growth and some type of something that stimulates their mind. Like, these young people are heavy into the video games and heavy into, you know, music and the arts and stuff like that. Incorporate that stuff into what you're doing. Change the bait.
What do you think? What's your opinion on this, Richard?
Yeah, I definitely echo the same sentiments that Chris brought up. And I think there's also a need for a generation that's not looking for perfection, per se. You know, like, we're trying to put on this perfect picture. But in all actuality, they're not responding to the perfect picture. They're really responding to transparency. They're responding to people who are just like them, you know? But it all goes back to what I'm saying, being able to relate to them, you know? Yeah. I'm show you my triumphs, and I also show you my flaws, mm-hmm. you know? And I think that when we're able to relate people on their level, mm-hmm. and not just try to be so deep and wonderful that you're no longer relevant. And I think even myself, one thing that God showed me, even as a preacher, I didn't want to, even though I know a lot about theology and understand things about Hebrew and Greek, I would never go on and try to preach that and preach to a person's intellect. But I always, my aim is to reach the person who I used to be. You know, because if I came into a church and somebody was giving me Greek and giving me Hebrew and all this history and doxology and all that, that would not relate to me. Yeah. What would relate to me is somebody who came flat-footed and be like, this is what it is. Yeah. I've messed up just like you. But let me tell you how good God is, because I went through this and now you can get through that, and God wants to use that. Would inspire me, you know. So every time I get up, it's all about reaching the same person who I used to be. And I think that we all came out of wherever we came out of, mm-hmm. so that we can be able to reach those same people, you know, because we are the bait, and our lifestyles, everything that we've been through, even the bad stuff, even the stuff that we don't like talking about. If somebody needs to hear how God brought you over so that you can actually be the key to show them the way, the same way God brought you out and the path that you came, be like, listen, hey, take this route. Mm-hmm. The reason I'm here is because I went around the corner, went downstairs, and now I can show you to get you to where I'm at, you know, and you have somebody that's actually been there for you, and I'm willing to be there for you because, you know what, somebody was there for me, yeah. and we can do this together. Bottom line.
I love that. I mean, we're going to play some more music from you now, Richard. Mm-hmm. This track we're going to play is called God's Own.
Brand new.
An exclusive.
Exclusive. Big tune that.
Okay. So tell me about this track. What's it about?
I think it's kind of like what we were talking about before. You know, it's called the God Zone. What is the God Zone? Mm-hmm. The God Zone is just being who God called you to be and walking in your element, walking in your assignment. Jesus called this to be a light unto the world, a city on a hill. So this is what this song is about, us being that light, us being relevant, and not just so focused on religion, but focused on a relationship with God and showing the world who God is in our own particular personal way.
Okay, well, I'm going to let you do the honors and introduce this track. All right,
this is the world premiere. This song is so new, Chris hasn't even really heard it yet.
I'm highly offended.
So he's going to be hearing it for the first time. This is the exclusive on New Style Radio, 98.7 FM, going down in Birmingham. Let's get it. God's on your...
Dauphin, I like that
Chris Dauphin.
Yeah.
Chris
we are one. We are one. We are one. Brothers, we are synonymous.
Did we just... You know what?
Did you see what I did? You said you were brothers.
That is my brother.
Exactly. Like,
why you gotta be Chris Dauphin?
Chris Dauphin.
Why it couldn't be Rich Thompson?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, my gosh, shame. Okay. Richard Dauphin, sorry. Track called God's Own. I like that track. It's the first time I've heard that.
Yes, and everybody in the room probably heard it for the first time. No. World premiere.
I mean, how do you guys feel about being here in the UK and performing on stage? Because you're kind of mirroring what you do in New York, or back in the States, I should say.
Yeah.
By coming over, I mean, the GL event is a very community-focused, it's youth-led. You know, I mean, how do you feel about that?
I think it's an awesome experience. You know, this is kind of like the dream. You know, you want to be able to share your music all across the world. And even though myself and Chris, you know, we performed all over, you know, in the States and in New York, but to be able to actually come across seas into a whole nother continent, you right. know, to be able to share the gift that God's given you yeah. is an awesome experience. And I've been watching, you know, all the GLIs in the past, you know, the concerts. Yeah, when Slave and my boy Richie Righteous came out here, you know, I was there, me and Close, I was looking at all the footage and be like, man, one day. You know what I mean? So it's a blessing and honor to be here.
So you knew about the show way before
yes.
you got asked
yes.
to.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
What's the response to the show in the States in the gospel scene?
Everybody that I know, that's from the States, they've heard about it or seen it because of Marcus. So the response is great. Everybody's like, yo, I would love to go out there. It's not like, nobody knows. It's something that, that's like on the bucket list. If I could go to England and rock out there with GL Lab, it's dope. It's good.
Oh, love it.
Y'all know what dope means?
Well, I know it's not drugs.
Yes, but, yes, yeah, exactly. you better clarify that. That's not the context you said it in.
The context.
Get context. Don't just mean like it's cool.
Yeah.
Clean that up.
Yeah.
People look at us crazy.
We have MTV.
Oh, that's right. That's right.
Yeah,
we have MTV.
Make sure. So, what are your? Have you checked out any UK artists here? Is there anyone that you particularly love? I'm gonna direct this at you, Richard.
Yes. I checked out Faith Child. You know, I definitely checked out one of his music videos, and I was just like, you know what? This is a real good look, and I was like, yo, I like this, you know. And I've definitely been a fan of Dwayne Tryon, you know.
Yeah,
I
definitely.
You know, Dwayne's definitely one of my favorite artists, you know. Okay. Dwayne Tryon.
What about you, Chris?
So I had the opportunity to meet the gentleman on the flyer today. I can't remember his name.
Roper.
Okay.
He is super cool. So I didn't get a chance to hear his music, but just him as a person.
Yeah.
He had me dying. We had a little bet going.
Yeah. It was a battle. It was warfare.
Who was able to say African names, and he spelled it out, and somebody's name like had a in it.
He's from Zimbabwe, so the conversation started out, be like, okay, so how do you say your name? Because my best friend's from Nigeria, and I was able to say his first, last, and his middle name, you know. And it was like, wow. How would you say your name? It's like, you guys will never be able to get it. And then he goes, like, okay, write it out. So we wrote it down, and then both myself and Chris are sitting there like, how do you even begin to find the pronunciation?
First of all, there was an N and a Q right next to each other. How?
Oh gosh. Okay. So, well, Faith Child is actually hosting the event on Saturday, and we're going to play a track from him. He's a MOBO award-winning artist. Yeah. Here. I mean, what is the big thing that you love about the UK gospel scene?
I love the accents. Everything sounds a million times cooler, you know.
Except for when y'all say Saturday.
Saturday. What wrong with Saturday?
It's Saturday. There's a UR in there. It needs to be pronounced.
This is his stance. This is Saturday. A firm stance on. Listen,
when y'all come out on Saturday.
Saturday.
Listen, we're not going to fight that fight here.
How do y'all say
you guys win?
Saturday.
Saturday it is.
Saturday.
That's what I say.
That sounds like, I'm not even going to say.
That sounds like Robin is what you want.
I love culture, right? You gotta love culture.
Well, on Saturday,
see, look at that.
Faith Child will be hosting the GL Live event. So we're going to play a track from him now. This track's called Over Me. He'll be hosting the GL Live next event on Saturday. And you said you're looking forward to that.
Yes.
What else are you looking forward to about Saturday night?
I'm really looking forward to, you know, to see that energy out here in droves. I want to see everybody out and just really supporting the UK artists that are out here grinding, because it's very, very difficult to get support, to get promoters, to get behind, you know, homegrown artists. But Roger's doing a really good job with that. Sometimes, you know, you'll get a flyer.
Yeah.
And like the guys that are not from that city or from that state will be like the big picture, and then everybody else will be on these tiny little pictures. But I think they did a good job with the graphics to make everybody look equally as important. You know what I'm saying? Shout out to 8 Dazzle, cut over there. He did his thing.
Uh huh.
The man behind the graphics.
Yeah, definitely.
Now, in terms of your performance on Saturday, what can we expect? Because I'm
going to
play another track from you in a moment, Richard, called Fathers. But
my name is Chris.
Chris, oh my God.
We are a two-headed monster.
That's what happens.
You are brought into one person. It's the accent. It's
yeah, fine, that's
I
it.
Can't differentiate. It's like Saturday. No. Chris.
Yes.
In terms of your performance, what can we expect from you on Saturday night?
Just a lot of energy and... hopefully, you know, I don't jump off the stage, or at least try to.
Okay.
All right, but I'm thinking I am.
You're going to jump off the stage?
Yes.
Why not?
Right, you're 6 foot six.
So if I can gauge the ceiling to stage ratio,
yo, you will crowd surf the whole crowd.
Right.
In one shot.
In one shot.
While I'm still
one
on the
lead.
Stage.
One lead.
Just lead right over.
Just like, get out the way.
Yeah, you can expect some really good energy, some really good music, and just a good time.
Well, we've got some people who are listening tonight that are actually looking forward to seeing you. I want to say a big shout out to Richard and Jackie and Billy and Jay who are listening, and some of our other listeners that are tuned into the show. And one of the things that has been said on the social media is how they really love your attitude towards your ministry. Do you see what you're doing when you're up there? It's very easy to get into the music and into the showmanship, but do you still see yourself as ministering in that process, Richard?
My name is Chris. I'm joking.
I'm going home.
I had to.
She's leaving.
I know, right? She's
leaving. So you were leaving tonight.
Exactly. You know, New York condition.
Exactly, you know.
It's all right. Don't worry about it.
Madness. You don't know
when
what you
look
unleash.
At me, but just go like that.
Just it's to let you know.
I'm going
to
be like, R. Put the name tag.
Yeah, I got you.
No, but seriously, I mean, do you see, is it ministry to you when you're up there as well?
I mean, it is definitely ministry. It's always ministry. And I think even when I could speak for Chris and myself, when we go up there, you know, yes, people are definitely, you know, into the music. That's a given. But what you notice and what you see on stage is you see our heart and our passion for God that goes beyond the music.
Right.
You know, we definitely share our lives. We share our experiences. And, you know, and I think that's how God uses both of us. I think we both minister in similar styles in different ways.
You're right.
You know, but at the end of the day, it's pretty much we're conveying the heart and mind of God, and ministry definitely goes forth. And God does what he does. You know, in every show, you know, somebody normally comes up to either him. I've seen how the power of God move on Chris's life and through his ministry on stage. Mm-hmm. And the same thing I see in myself. I come on stage and I'm like, wow. You know, God would just lead both of us. You know, I think to say something to somebody, even in between certain songs, mm-hmm. you know, and that in itself just really ministers to the hearts and the people, you know, and that's, you know, the fruit of how God does what he do.
Now, Chris.
Yes, that
we
would
have
be
a
me.
Track from you. Coming. I'm going to play a track from you now. This one's called Fathers.
Yes.
Tell me the inspiration behind this one and how it ended up on the album.
Well, honestly, the inspiration came when I worked with Rich at his after school program, because it was so many kids there and young men especially that did not have dads. Mm-hmm. And after 3 weeks of being with them and them saying to you, you know, you're the closest thing that I have to a father, after 3 weeks, the impact of that statement from one kid just like took me back. After 3 weeks, we're not talking about 3 years and 5 years of building a relationship. No, it was 3 weeks. And this kid came to me and said, I don't know my father, but you are the closest thing to a dad that I've had in a long time. And all I said to him was, yo, I'm proud of you. You did your thing. Mm-hmm. And he goes, nobody tells me that.
Wow.
And that led me to believe, like, fathers are so integral and key to the growth of a man or a woman. Mm-hmm. If you don't have that, then, you know, you're missing a part of that growth. That's sort of like being born without an umbilical cord.
Are there many, do you come across, is there a big demographic of young people who are fatherless back in the States? It's quite serious over here.
Yeah, it's see, I'm going to be honest with you, and I don't mean to over-spiritualize anything, but the devil really desires to take headship out of the home. Mm. So he'll do that through the avenues of not having a job, because a man's natural instinct is to provide. And if they can't provide, then they become frustrated. And if they're frustrated, you know, then their reaction to their wife or their girlfriend, however the situation may go, it may be something totally different. You know what I'm saying? Women love their men differently. Mm. Than a man loves his wife or his girlfriend or what have you. A man will love his wife through providing. Look what I got you. I bought you this, something nice for you to put on. A woman will be more affectionate and more emotionally into it. Not to say that a man won't, mm-hmm.
but it's just different. So when you take that element out, not only does it soil the child, but it soils the woman. And then the woman will say different crazy things about the dad. And then the kid will look at the dad, you know, strange because you wasn't here. But these elements are what my, I love the way my pastor says it. He says, and big shout out to Change Your Lives Christian Center in Brooklyn. Shameless plug for you, Pastor Paul B. Mitchell. But he always says that, you know, we are the sum total of our experience. Everything that you've been through really made you who you are right now, as an adult, as a child, everything up until this particular moment in your life. That is what has made you. So if you didn't grow up with a father, you have a skewed view. Even if you have a family right now, you don't really know the role of a dad. You only know what the Huxtables have shown you, you know what I'm saying, or things on TV. And that's not always the reality of it, you know? So that was the inspiration behind this. Did I just go off?
Go in.
No.
Go in somewhere.
I haven't actually finished. So as a man in the church, yeah. A father yourself?
Yes.
Yes. How much pressure do you feel to be that role model, to be that father figure now for young people, male and female, in the community that are looking to you in that way?
For me, honestly, it's no pressure. You know why? Because I was created to do this. So unless God does not give me what I need, then I can't do it. Mm-hmm. But he gives me what I need in order to do it. So the provision is there. So all I can do is just be in the right place. Mm-hmm. Just like he told Elijah, he said, you know, go to the brook. And there is where I'll feed you. As long as I'm in the place called there, there's nothing else that ever really matters. I'll always have the provision to pour out into other people and to give, as long as my heart is pure, as long as when I raise my hands, you know, my hands are clean.
Yeah.
And I just wanted to add briefly, just that's why I kind of like with the songs like, you know, God's Own and songs like Revolution.
Why do you have to go back to your song, bro?
Can I finish?
We were
can
talking about my song.
You see, and I was getting ready to get into his song.
Okay.
You know, right, to talk right, about. Right. You know what I'm saying? I'm trying to.
I just felt the way about
listen,
that.
Listen, I'm just trying to make you look good because you are horrible right now.
Maybe it's my allergy.
I'm
over here.
I'm saying, this is the cost of the cross. But let me get to the
top.
Let me stay focused. Let me just stay focused.
Go ahead.
All right. Nah, but that's why it's so important for men. But even as believers, you know, and I'm speaking even when we're talking the subject of manhood, it's why it's so important for us to be intentional in being who God has called us to be, because we don't know whose life we're influencing, you know, and not just influence a life by accident. No, definitely be intentional. Be like, look, you, I don't know you, but guess what? I'm going to speak life into you. Because this might be the only time you're going to see me. And this might be the only time that he's actually going to come across anybody who is going to be willing to actually speak a word into anybody's life.
Right,
you know.
Right.
So I think what Chris said is definitely right on the money. And as believers, we definitely do need to take a stand and be as intentional and proactive in making a difference in the lives of individuals all across the world.
Amen. So Chris, I'm going to ask you to introduce your track.
Yeah, this is... Fathers. It's produced by my boy Irby Lubin. And yes, that is me singing on the hook. But anyway.
Shameless plug.
Guys, about your influence in the community and your influence working with young people. How much of a perfect fit is it then that you're working with GL, who have such a young community influence around what they're doing?
For me, what's crazy is I didn't even know that. Mm. I had no idea that he was doing that until everybody was saying, like, wow, you know, they would hear what we're doing. They're like, oh, wow, yeah, it makes sense.
Oh, so you're the Roger Moore in the States.
Right.
We heard that last night. Yeah, you know, we're the Roger Moore in the States.
We heard that last night.
Yeah, I was like, okay, look at that.
Seriously, wow.
Yeah, so, I mean, it's for me, like, you see, sometimes God does things, right? Mm. And we're too stupid to put two and two together. Like, I'm serious, like, he'll orchestrate something that will help there and here, and he'll tie it together and put it together with a nice little bow, and 3 years from now, you'll be like, oh, that's why they put Chef Boyardee in the can. You know what I'm saying? Like, y'all know what Chef Boyardee is?
No.
You just lost the entire country.
Never mind.
Just on that
side. It's like Canned. That's like canned food.
Yeah. Oh, canned food.
Forget it.
Tin food, yeah.
Tin food. That's why we have tin food.
We have tin food. Anyway,
Yeah. So, I mean, yeah, I thought it was cool.
Yeah.
I thought it was cool. One plants, one waters, God gets the increase. You never know which process you're a part of.
Very true. I mean, Richard...
That's great recovery, man.
Sorry, we are bad. We are the two of us are bad.
You two actually are hilarious together. You can kind of see that the bond goes beyond like just two people sat by side by side. What is it that you admire about each other?
He's gonna say my height, but you know what I'm saying? I'm gonna wait for him to say it. Go for it, baby boy. Go for it.
Actually, you know what I admire the most?
Do it.
I admire the most.
My leg length. Go ahead. Say it.
Listen.
Say it. Lift me up. Let me stand up. You know what?
I shouldn't have asked that.
You know what? Let me just...
You deserve the glory. And the I exalt you.
No!
Chris.
That me. That's what you want? Oh, just my height. Just my height. Just the height.
Oh my gosh.
Just the height.
You deserve the glory and the honor and the praise.
Okay.
You. Best friend, you.
Oh, man.
Right, best friend. I'm scrapping that question.
No.
It was
because you want to know what I admire about Rich?
Like, open the door.
I got it. You know what I admire about Rich?
Okay, what do you admire?
I admire Richard's... his willingness and the brain that he has won't allow him to stop. So whatever he does, I don't care if it's putting together a toy, driving a car, he's not gonna stop it. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? It's just like, and he's 130% into whatever he does. So Rich cannot multitask.
Right.
Because he wants to give 100% to whatever he's doing. And if he can't give 100% to it, he won't do it. I admire that because I'm a 30-30-30-10 kind of guy. But anyway, that's
the whole thing. You're a 30-10
kind of guy. Yep.
Okay.
Amen.
Amen.
I would say when it comes down to Chris, he's probably helped me the most in, I think, his realness. Like, he's one person that if you ask him a question, he's going to tell you the truth, whether you like it or not. And even with me, because there was a time where I was kind of like, even if I wanted to say certain things, but I didn't think that I necessarily had the heart or the skin to actually say something. But I kind of like tap into like, what would Chris say? And then, you know what?
And you end up in trouble.
Exactly. You know what I mean? But I definitely respect, you know, his honesty. Like, what you see is what you get from him, you know? And I think that's something I definitely do admire and I take from him.
That's amazing. Well, we're going to talk about the event now because we're coming to the end of the show. But so this Saturday it's happening at the Drum GL Live.
Yes.
It's the 10th edition.
Going down.
And I want to bring Roger in now. He's been kind of keeping quiet.
Come on, good sir.
Never too many interviews. Roger, I mean, how do you feel about having these guys in the lineup? Because I can already tell that energy's just going to be a bit nuts on Saturday.
To be honest, it's actually quite cool because, like, it's kind of weird when you bring up American acts. It's like, oh gosh, you know what the guy could be like. You know, even though, you know, Frank got like a mutual friend who kind of links this whole up. And we talk and we reason, and I specify to him, I don't want no drama when it comes to America. Cause I've seen it all. I've seen great artists. Total dramas, I've seen egos and whatever, and that's what I don't need around young people.
Yeah,
I've seen young people cry at my events because of the way, I'm not going to name out the artist, a major rap artist went on and they cried because the way he went on. So it's like, what's that going to do? That breaks down everything I'm trying to do, you know, and it's about Christ, not even myself, you know. And I think that, you know, so for me it's imperative, and just after a couple of minutes I was like, yo, these guys are actually quite cool, and so the confidence of their like almost like joke, but at the end of the day, bottom line, they're serious. Listen to the music, they're serious.
Yeah.
Listen to the words, and it's about Christ, and at the same time, you know, it's kind of weird that we all work with young people, but you know, we all see there's a major issue within our communities that the church is not directly working with.
It's the
same thing wherever you are. There's a massive disconnect, and like Chris said, they're just doing the same thing, and I think that people think that relevance is to do with age, it has nothing to do with age, because right. it's about your ability to change, mm-hmm. you know, and technology has changed over the past 20, 30 years mm. massively. I left school and there's only 5 screens, computer screens, that were colour when I left school. Mm-hmm. I'm not sure my age yet. That was, you know,
yeah, we, are we, 1937,
we was on Paintbrush going, wow, look what I can do.
Paintbrush!
Oh my
we was like this going, yo, we do some amazing stuff in Paintbrush, yeah? yeah? But now, like, iPhone, technology, and everything. Right. If I didn't evolve, I'd be like some of my friends who can't even use Excel. So the key thing for me is a case of evolving and moving with times. Yeah. And I think the church needs to do this now, needs to work in the community, needs to, if I can't do it, let me support the guys who can.
Let me throw this out to you, because I was reading an article and listening to, I was doing some research this week, as I always do, and it was an article about the church, saying that church numbers are declining. However, church is changing its form. It's not the building as we know it. I mean, this is church. What you're doing right now is church, and with the power of the of technology, of the internet, we're able to have I'm able to have church with you in Birmingham when you're in New York. You know, there is no distance between us anymore. Yeah. How do you see what God is doing at a time like this? Because I see it in a positive way, whereas many are looking at it like, oh, we need
to.
I think we're doing it. I really think the fact that you're sat here now on my show, we're doing it. That's what I think.
Absolutely. I think that, you know, sometimes it's better off half the church walks out. Mm. Because you know what? Because if you're not in church, you know what I'm saying, or part of Christianity, you know, you might as well just chill at home and watch TV, you know. And I think too often people are in church and not actually are Christians, you know. Let's be all, but the problem is that we measure by membership or whatsoever, yeah. Mm-hmm. But let's take that aside, yeah. The real numbers, you know, what are they really? And I'd rather strong message, 20 people walk out or whatsoever because the message is convicting the heart, mm. than people just chilling, enjoying church and whatsoever. And I think the tradition of church is getting out of fashion, mm-hmm. which is great. You know what I mean? Because I'd rather people come to church not because of fashion or because of Christ.
But this generation are going to hear you preach the word of God in a way that they can understand. I mean,
100%.
Just very quickly, Chris. I mean, how do you see it?
For me, I love the change that's happening. Yeah. And I'm all for, you know, delivering a message that is relevant, practical, and applicable right now. Mm. I was talking with Raj and everybody yesterday, and I said I remember when I was younger that, you know, I heard people preach messages that said, you know, they talked about Job, and they said, you know, they glorified, God gave him double for his trouble. That was like the name of their message for Job. But for me, I always looked at it like, but he lost his entire family. Mm-hmm. You know, how you can't get over that. You don't just, God is not a mind wiper. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. He's a healer, but your mind is still there. So when you look at your new set of family, your new set of children, you still remember. Mm-hmm. And as it concerns what we do now versus what was done then, you cannot put new wine into old wineskins.
Yeah.
They will burst, and I think the bursting is happening, and more pastors are seeing, I am losing members, but they refuse to change. My pastor preached one time, he said, if we don't change, we'll die. You'll die spiritually, you'll die physically, you'll die mentally, because you're so, you ever been to a place where they won't change anything? Like, you can walk out of there today, go back in there 2 years from now, and it's like the total same. The same message, the same shout, the same dance. I'm personally, as a believer, I'm over it. I need to grow. Mm. I need to go somewhere and be brutally punished by the word of God to change. Amen. I don't want to feel good and then go home and still face the same stuff and not have a solution. Mm. It doesn't make any sense. If there's no solution, then ultimately people say, then there's no God.
Amen. And that's thrown at us all too often, I think, because there's no change. I mean, Saturday's event, guys, what do you think it's going to do for the community? Let's talk about the people that are coming, because there's many who've been listening now and saying, you know what, I feel like I'm drawn to come. But what do you feel like it's going to do? What are they going to get out of it?
I think let's not just lie, because sometimes when we do Christian events, we focus on how the Lord's going to speak to you, whatsoever. But it's going to be a great show. It's going to be entertainment wise. It's going to be a quality event. You're going to have I was measuring the other day, when you work out the set list and whatsoever, and I'm measuring there's going to be 3 hours of live artists, and that is totally, totally powerful for me. And for me, it's a case of not only great US acts, you got great UK wide acts, you got great local acts. And so for me, I listen to everyone's music and I'm going, yo, this thing's going to be actually a serious event. And me, myself, Roger, I'm going to enjoy the event. Everyone else, they can just whatever the one they need to do.
All right.
I'm going to enjoy the night. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah. You should. I'm definitely expecting the same, man. I believe that, God has definitely put this together just by looking at the backgrounds of our lives and how they are so closely intertwined. I think that right there, in and of itself, says that God is up to something, because we are of like mind and of like spirit. Yeah. So God just doesn't do stuff like that just to, you know what I'm saying? It's like there's a plan and there's a purpose for everything under the sun, and for such a time as such a time as now, because very critical moment in our culture and in our time, where the young people are getting crazier, the events that are happening are getting crazier. If you look at stuff that's happening now versus when you were young, or 5 years ago, 8 years ago, you're like, yo, as my grandmother would say, Jesus soon to come.
Yeah. And even to answer to your question was how do you see the church, or how do we actually impact this generation? I think I remember my pastor said, even though numbers are growing, what are we doing for those that have not, that have turned their backs on church? How do we go and reach them? And as I was talking to the other youth pastor at my church, I was like, we need to do things unconventional, break out of tradition, bring forth that change that, Chris was talking about, and even with GLI, GLIX, this is the alternative. This is just another opportunity for God to be God in an unconventional way. So this is the perfect example of what we're doing in order to rescue those that have fallen away and those that need to be returned back to the house of refuge, so that they can know and be impacted by the awesome and almighty, prolific God.
Okay, so for those who are listening, tell us, where do we get tickets? When does it start? Give us the details.
Okay, yeah, if you want to get tickets, you can get through the drum box office. But before, there's always people asking about, can I get tickets in the door? Yes, there's going to be tickets on the doors.
Yeah.
It's going to be £10 for adults. It's going to be £7.50 for students, OAPs. Yes, I said OAPs. OAPs. Young people, under 16. So it's going to be at an affordable price. Listen, I think it worked out to be less than £1 for each artist, so there's no excuses here. It's going to be great value. But the key thing is, guys, come to the drum. Everyone knows where that is in Birmingham. And if any issues, if you want to find out more information, hashtag GLLiveX, or follow us at GL on Twitter at GL360.
Hashtag GLLiveX or at GL360 on Twitter.
Yeah, on Twitter.
That's the one. Okay, and guys, where can we find out more about your music? Very quickly.
Well, you guys can definitely hit me up on www.richarddauphin.com. Dauphin, that's D-A-U-P-H-I-N. You can also hit me up on Twitter, Instagram, Facebook, Richard Dauphin. I'm all there.
All there.
My website is I Am Chris Music. I had to think for a second. I Am Chris Music. And you can check that out. You can go to my Instagram is at I Am Chris Music _SMM, and my Twitter is at I Am Chris Music. You can check me out there as well.
Okay, well, so I want to say a big thank you to you guys for coming in onto the show.
Thank you.
It's been a pleasure having you, and I just love everything you said this evening. So, and I really hope that people have been inspired to move forward from some of the things you've said tonight. And we're going to play out with only one of your tracks. So I don't want a 10-hour argument about whose it's going to be.
Because it can happen right now.
That's why I'm saying.
How much time we got left? We're going.
It's not going down.
Oh, man.
Who? Okay, so we've either got a track from you, Richard, or a track from you, Chris.
You know what I want you to do? What? I want you to play B.O.D.
B.O.D. Okay, I'm going to play B.O.D.
That's good.
So tell me about B.O.D. then. Well, this is off your...
Yeah, this is going off the promo CD that's going to be available exclusively here in Birmingham, man. B.O.D. is just a song that it's actually like a freestyle, pretty much. You know, I just put together, and it's really just talking about, we were talking about how we approach ministry. You know what I mean? Just that relentless approach and attack to ministry, daring to be different, and letting God's word be heard by any means necessary.
Now, there's two B.O.D.s. There's B.O.D. 1 and
B.O.D.
Part 2?
Yeah, there's a Part 2 and a Part 1. If you want to play both of them back to back, it's cool, because songs are short enough.
Which one do you want me to play?
Play Part 1, man. B.O.D. Part 1. Let's get it.
Okay, so I'm going to ask you to introduce the track.
All right, well, it's going down here on New Style Radio, 98.7 FM. It's going down. I need y'all to go ahead and check it out. The video is also on my website, B.O.D., which stands for Bars on Deck.
Bars on Deck. I want to say a big shout out to all of the listeners tonight. Thank you so much for all your texts and messages. Make sure you get down there at the drum this Saturday, April the 16th.